Welcome to the lecture series on computer organization. Today we will discuss about cache memory. The main principle behind this cache memory is the locality of reference. That means, first one is temporal locality. That means, if a CPU accesses a particular instruction at a particular location, then there is more probability that it will be accessed in future also. That means if a instruction is executed recently, then there is more probability that same instruction is executed again. That is called temporary locality. Similarly, we are having spatial locality. If a particular instruction is accessed in a particular location in memory, then there is more probability that the instructions in the neighboring locations are also accessed by the CPU. That means, if a particular instruction I is accessed at location L, then there is more probability that the CPU will access the location at L plus 1. So that is the logic behind this. Basing on these two principles, cache memory was introduced. It is situated in between main memory and CPU. So if you see this, if CPU wants to execute any programs or any instructions, first it will search in cache memory. If it is found in the cache memory, then it is immediately accessed by the CPU and it will be executed. Unfortunately, if it is not present in the cache memory, it will be accessed from the main memory. So during accessing, one copy will be brought into cache memory and start executing. Okay, the reason behind this transfer of instructions into cache memory is very simple. Cache memory speed is comparatively speed is more than the main memory because of difference in hardware technology. Because of this reason, this cache memory was introduced. The main thing is to improve the speed. Okay, if you see this, compare the main memory and cache memory, the size of cache memory is small when compared to main memory. If the cache memory is also large, means then it will take more time in searching. So for that reason, and also the cost, because of cost also, this size of the cache memory is purposefully made small when compared to main memory. So therefore, in short, you can assume that cache memory stores the frequently used instructions in the main memory. So thereby, the CPU, if it needs any instruction to be executed, first it will search in the cache memory. So that is how the location of a particular instruction is done by the CPU. The performance of cache is always depends upon the hit ratio. We already told that if the instruction which is required by the CPU is present in cache memory, then only the speed will be improved. If it is not present in the cache memory, then it has to be brought from the main memory and it should start executing. And also you should make a copy here in cache memory. So thereby some speed is somewhat reduced. If there is a hit in the instruction searched by the CPU, then you will gain more speed. If you don't find the instruction in the cache memory, definitely we will call it as miss. So the speed depends upon the hit ratio. The speed depends on the hit ratio. So for that purpose, we will not store a single word at a particular location. For a particular location in main memory, you will store a set of instructions which we will call it as a block from main memory, and you will store it in the cache memory. Because of spatial locality and temporal locality, you will bring a copy of a block, whole block, into the cache memory, not a single instruction or single word. Okay, so thereby there is more chance that you will improve the hit ratio. Now the thing is, CPU always presents the memory address, but you need to access cache memory. So how it is possible? How to convert this memory address into cache address? That is a problem. Mapping function. So here the mapping function is how to map the memory blocks onto the cache blocks. That is a main problem here. Simply you cannot, you know, you cannot transfer the blocks present in the memory to cache. If you do that, it will mismatch with the address generated by the CPU. Okay, CPU always generates the address. With the address only, you need to search in the cache as well as memory. So there should be proper mapping between memory blocks onto the cache blocks. Otherwise, your CPU cannot locate. So in literature, we are having three types of mapping: associative mapping, directive mapping, set associative mapping. So let us assume the block consists of only one word or one instruction. So in this associative memory, we will use the CAM address, CAM memory type. That means content addressable memory. In content addressable memory, any data is accessed with the help of content, not by address. In general, a memory is accessed by, any location is accessed by its address. When you queue the address, the data present in that address, it will be retrieved. Whereas in CAM, it is not like that. You will identify a particular data in a location with the help of mapping by the contents. So, and hence the name we will call it as content addressable memory. There is no address. So, in content addressable, you will have two fields. One field for storing the address, another field for storing the word or data. So, when the CPU generates 15-bit address, first you will store it in the argument register. The address in the argument register, it will be mapped with all the contents, left-hand contents of CAM. Whenever it is matched corresponding to that location, the data in the content addressable memory, it will be given to the CPU. It will be given something like this. When the CPU gives address 15 bits to the CAM, this is CAM, you will have address field and data field. So it will be mapped into this location and the corresponding data will be given to the, this data may be operand or instruction. In this way, the blocks or the instructions present in the cache memory, this is accessed with the help of memory address. Always the CPU generates memory address. Next technique is direct mapping. In this direct mapping, let us assume your CPU generates 15-bit address. Your 15-bit address is divided into two parts. One is a tag consists of 6 bits and index consists of 9 bits. 6 bits and 9 bits, that means the bottom 9 bits, they are used for accessing the particular location, the cache memory, and the remaining 6 bits are used to identify a particular location in the main memory. So that means if you carefully observe this, this is our main memory and this is our cache memory. The cache memory size is just 512 locations. Each location stores 12 bits. Similarly, main memory is having 32 locations. Each is storing 12 bits here. So in direct mapping, whenever the CPU generates 15-bit address, whenever the CPU generates 15-bit address, let us say for example, if the CPU generates 0277, if the CPU generates 0277, immediately first it will access the cache memory for identifying the instruction with respect to that address. So in this way, if you see this, the lower 9 bits, 777, actually this is an octal system, so each digit is represented by 3 bits. So the lower 3 octal digits, that means 777, is separated and it is used for indexing the cache memory. So while indexing the cache memory, you will identify this location. Again, this location consists of both tag and data. Both tag and data. So since CPU generates 02, this top level 6 bits, they are compared with the tag field in the cache memory. So whenever it is matches, then the data will be sent to the CPU. This is something like this. When the CPU generates 16-bit address, let us say for example 02777 generates this address, first the CPU searches in the cache memory. In the cache memory, you will have two fields. One is tag field, another is data field. The location starts from 000 to 777. Let us suppose this cache memory, this is your cache memory. CPU generates 02777. So these bits are separated. The lower three order, lower three digits, they are used as indexing in cache memory. So after searching here, you will identify the location as here. After identifying the location, the top three bits used to compare the tag field in the cache memory. Let us, for example, your cache memory contains the tag field of 02. So therefore, 02 is matched with this tag. The address of the tag field and the tag field of cache memory is matched. So the data present in this location, say for example 1, 2, 3, 4, this will be sent to the CPU. Why you need this tag means sometimes the CPU may generate address like this also, because the CPU always generates the address in the memory address range. Let us say, for example, 01777. In this case, CPU is asking for 01777 data, but your cache is stored only 02777 data only. So in this case, the CPU misses the data, whereas in this case, it hits the data. Even though 777 location is there, but unfortunately the tag value is here, it is 02. But if CPU generates this address, you need to have the tag value of 01. If it is there only, you need to give the data to the CPU. Otherwise, it should not. So this is how the data is transferred from main memory and it is stored in the cache like this. So when the CPU generates address, with the help of tag field and index field, you will identify a particular data. This is called direct mapping cache organization. So here, in this case, if CPU generates 01777 address, at first time instant, this is the present scenario. If you want 01111 data, you have to update the cache. That means you have to update this location. When you encounter this situation, that is a miss, if it is a hit, no problem. Simply you will fetch the data and you give to the CPU. If you encounter miss means, then you have to do something like this. You have to remove the data. This is your cache. Since previously the 01777 data is not available in cache, so you need to fetch from the main memory. Let us suppose this is your main memory. Let us suppose 999 is the data present in this location. So that will be brought here. This is our cache. And the tag value for this location is 01. It is updated here. So there are two cases in direct mapping. When CPU generates address, the index field of the address is mapped in the cache memory, and after that tag field is also mapped and it is compared. If both are equal, then only the data is given to CPU. If it is not mapped means the data is not available. That means it is called a miss. In such a case, you need to fetch from the main memory and you have to store it in the cache. That means you have to replace the old values. That means here in this case, What are the old values? 0, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. So you need to update in the main memory. Let us suppose 02777. So this value you store it here. You cannot simply delete the old values because there may be a situation that CPU may have changed this data. So it is always better to update the values in the main memory. So this is called direct mapping. Similarly, the same thing you can apply for block of words also. Block of words. And finally, set associate to memory. In set associate to mapping, you will build the cache with set size of 2. That means it is an extension of direct mapping. Instead of having one tag field, here you are having two tag fields and two data fields. That means in the set associated to your cache memory, you will have two sets of location like this. Zero, zero, zero. Okay, 7. This is your tag. This tag. So in the previous case, just we expanded the size of the cache memory. So in the previous example, we can store two types of data with two different addresses. One with 01777, 02777. For 02777, it is we can store two data. Thereby, by doing this, we can increase the hit ratio percent. That is the main thing here. So here also the same case. Here also the same explanation holds as far as direct mapping. If there is a hit, if you found a particular instruction in the cache memory, actually this thing will, here we are referring it as instruction or data, whatever it is. If there is a hit, you access the instruction, CPU accesses the instruction from cache. If there is a miss, that means you don't found the instruction, then CPU will fetch memory, means here it is main memory, from main memory, and stores in the indexed cache location and at the same time old catch values are stored in main memory. So this is what is happening in the set associated to cache memory. This is how the blocks from main memory is stored in cache memory. So whenever CPU generates a memory address, so without any conflict, the instructions are accessed by the CPU smoothly. So we have discussed three types of mapping techniques: associative mapping, direct mapping, cache mapping. So we can also improve the set size also. So the next important thing we need to discuss is the replacement policy, or you can say as a block replacement policy. We already discussed that the size of cache memory is limited. So whenever you are bringing new set of instructions from main memory to cache memory, this is main memory, small cache. If the cache is already full, so when the CPU wants new set of instructions, then the CPU, it has to throw the old set of instructions into the main memory. And new set of instructions onto the same locations. This is called as replacement policy, block replacement policy. The CPU will follows different types of block replacement policy. This is one block. Always a set of instructions are transferred between cache and main memory. The set, we will call it as a block. So on what basis this set of instructions are swapped? Here it is new instructions and old instructions, old block. On what basis old blocks are replaced? That is a point here. So in literature we are having LRU technique, least recently used. That means the block in cache which is least recent used, that means which is not used by the CPU frequently, is chosen for replacement. Okay. The block which is not used recently, which is least recently used, that block is chosen for replacement and it is stored in the main memory, and new block is stored in the same cache location. Again, here there is one thing. If this chosen block is not modified by the CPU, then you need not transfer that block into main memory. There is no need, because that block is already present in main memory. Since the CPU doesn't change that block, simply you can delete that block. That's it. There is no need for writing into the main memory. If the block is modified by the CPU, then you should write into the same location of main memory in order to have consistent results. Two types of write operations performed by CPU. In cache write, if CPU wants to perform write operation onto cache, let us suppose this is a cache. This is memory. When CPU performs write operation on a particular block, it will be updated parallelly in both cache as well as in memory block. Both operation will take parallelly. Whereas in this is cache write through. In cache write back, if CPU wants to perform write operation on a particular block, then first it will update in the cache first. That operation will be performed in the cache first. After the instruction execution, program execution is over, that means after execution is over, then the changes made in that block, it will be updated in the main memory. That means in cache write through, the changes will be done parallelly in both cache as well as memory. Whereas here, first it will be done in cache, after the program execution is over, then the changes made in that block, it will be reflected from cache onto the memory. So that is a logic behind this. So two types of write operation mechanisms can be performed in catch. So these two are, you can follow any one of this technique. You can prefer this technique. This is somewhat advantageous. So when you are replacing the blocks, when you are replacing or swapping the blocks from cache to main memory, you can use this policy. You can replace the block in a simple manner. If the block is not at all modified, means you need not update in the main memory. Simply you will delete the block. That's it. If the block is changed, means you need to perform updation in the main memory also.